And Woodlawn welcomes you to worship this morning. I am Reverend Mary Lynn White, and we thank you for joining us for this 16th Sunday after Pentecost during the second week, I guess, of creation time. We are celebrating creation, and we give thanks for God's beautiful creation and our part in it. And we give thanks for you, those of you who are here, actually sitting in the pews, which is wonderful. And we give thanks for those who are watching online as well. The team working here today is Gus on keyboards, Bev on sound, Peter on PowerPoint, although it was created by Jennifer, Paul behind the camera, and Katie here to do story time. We also have several ushers and volunteers helping out this morning just to make sure things run smoothly, so thank you to one and all. You may have guessed that this is our first in-person worship since COVID-19 began back in March. So we are very happy to have people in the pews and socially distanced with masks, of course, and obeying all the COVID-19 rules. So one of the rules is that helps keep everyone safe is that there will be no singing. But if you are wearing a mask, you can hum along to the recordings of the Woodlawn congregation singing the hymns and responses. And those at home, of course, with the words on the screen, you're allowed to sing. As well, spoken responses are not permitted at this time, but you'll hear a recording of Woodlawn's congregation praying the Lord's Prayer and saying a new creed. So I guess the only other thing is to ask you to remain seated throughout the service until an usher leads you to one of the exits, and that would be after the postlude, because we want to make sure we enjoy Gus's postlude before everyone goes. So thank you very much for your patience and cooperation. Next week, I will not be here, but we are fortunate to have Ralph Sams, who will be leading worship and preaching. So thank you to Ralph. On behalf of Woodlawn United, I'd like to extend Christian condolences to the family and friends of Jeannie Young, who died this past Friday. As well, Christian condolences to Ernie and Betty Nickerson and family on the recent death of Ernie's brother, Warren, in Victoria, BC. Our thoughts and prayers go out to both of these families. And now it is time for our statement of reconciliation. As we gather in this place, we remember with gratitude that we live and worship on lands that are by law the unceded territories of the Mi'kmaq. May we live with respect on this land and in peace and friendship with its people. Come and worship our amazing God, creator of the universe, for the vastness and beauty of God's creation is unparalleled. In love, God created our astounding earth and its awesome diversity of peoples. And in love, God remains faithful to all. Let us give thanks and let us worship. Let's praise God with a hymn from More Voices, number 42, Praise God for This Holy Ground. The Christ candle is a symbol of the ever-present and loving presence of Jesus Christ, the light of the world. May we sense the deep and abiding love that God has for creation and for each one of us as we focus on the light of this Christ candle. For God's love is amazing, and God loves us beyond imagination. Our gracious God is good and faithful, offering abundant life to all creation through Jesus Christ. May we, in response to God's faithfulness, strive to be loving and faithful to creation, to each other, and to God as we journey in faith. Let us take a moment for sacred silence. Let us pray. We thank you, most loving and gracious God, for Jesus Christ, the light of the world. And we thank you for your enduring and faithful love for us and all of creation. May our hearts and minds grasp this amazing insight and be open to the movement of your Holy Spirit as we worship today. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Morning. Isn't that breath of fresh air after you take off your mask just the best feeling? I am so excited to see so many wonderful and amazing faces in the pews today. And for our at-home pajama squad, we love you too. But I am so, so happy. The best thing this morning was hearing the most like joyful laughter out in the front lobby as people were coming in, and we're all getting used to being back, and it's just a wonderful feeling. And I know everyone is so excited to be able to see each other again, and I can tell you with full confidence that our team here is just as excited to see you. So, we are all back at school, and most of us are back to work now. I know everybody in my house is back at work, and making it through those early mornings. Anybody else very, very tired in the mornings? But we're doing this together, and we're doing it with the faith that wearing a mask is going to help, and social distancing is going to help, and we've seen that it's doing a pretty good job. And I think together as a people, we're doing a pretty good job. So you can always give yourself a little pat on the back for all the good stuff that we're doing together. Now, as you can probably tell, I'm very excited this morning because we just announced kids' programs are back on October 4th. Now, that will mean that you won't necessarily get to see me physically here, but you will get to see story time continuing in the future. It's just going to come in a new way for everybody, and that'll come with some cool surprises for the congregation as well, some possible cameos of the kids in the videos, here's hoping. But things are looking up, and although they're looking different, they're looking bright. So what are we talking about today? Well, we are talking about a parable that Jesus told in Matthew 20, verses 1 to 16. And for those of you who aren't totally sure what a parable is, it's a story about something that means something else. And that can sound a little confusing, but it's kind of like a story with a moral that you're supposed to learn, like the tortoise and the hare. We don't necessarily have talking animals that are racing in real life, but we learn that slow and steady wins the race kind of deal. That's the message that you take from it. And Jesus liked to teach with parables because it requires us to think critically and to try and think for ourselves and use our wonderful, beautiful minds to learn. And so Jesus was telling the story of these laborers. And so these laborers had agreed to work in a field for one silver coin. And then the landlord, who was working the field, saw a bunch of people standing around. He's like, "Hey, do you guys have nothing to do?" They were like, "No, sir, we have nothing to do." So he was like, "Oh, okay, well, how about you come work in the field and I will pay you one silver coin." And at the end of the day, the laborers who had been working the full day were upset. They're like, "Well, how come they get paid the same as us? That's not fair." And the landlord said to them, he said, "Why are you questioning my generosity? I'm giving what I can to all of you, regardless." And when we put that into like the thoughts that we think today, we're kind of like, "Well, that's not totally fair. Like, I worked longer, well, shouldn't I get more?" But what we're thinking about here is not just what you think you deserve. It is about what's given and the generosity and having faith that what's being given to you is good. And this relates to faith. So like I said, Jesus was talking about something that he wasn't necessarily talking about. So what Jesus is telling us here is that no matter when you come to God, no matter what mistakes you've made, no matter if you are sitting in the church pews every single week or maybe once in a while, you are unconditionally loved. And that our faith, you can't compare faith, or you can't compete with other people to who can be the best Christian. It's about love and this unconditional love that we are offered by Jesus. And I think that's just wonderful. And do you remember the stones I had last week, the control, compare, and compete? Well, this is one of those cases where these laborers were competing and trying to control the situation, and they were unhappy. But when we have that faith in what's given to us, we're more happy. And what we reap is more bountiful. And that what we're getting is love. And it's God's love. So you know that it is unconditional, forgiving, and full. Now, before I head back to my seat and we listen to some more beautiful music, how about we all pray together? Dear God, thank you for giving us your love unconditionally. Thank you for the faith that we have in you and for never judging us based on our lives behind us and only judging us based on our love. We thank you for the unconditional love that you offer to each and every soul on this earth. And we thank you for all those moments when life seems a little tough, but you're there. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gus. That was beautiful. And thank you, Katie. Well done. I actually don't have to preach now. That was very well done. We're on the same wavelength, let's put it that way. The scripture reading today is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 20, verses 1 to 16. And as you heard Katie say, Jesus is speaking to his disciples using a parable to explain the kingdom of heaven. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" And they said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. Through the reading of this scripture, may you hear the word of God. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation that comes from those words be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The Gospel of Matthew talks about God's kingdom as the kingdom of heaven, whereas the Gospel of Luke speaks of God's kingdom as the kingdom of God. They are one and the same, and they refer to God's kingdom here and now on earth, right through life, after death, in the eternal kingdom. The place where we refer to as heaven. Perhaps a better way of explaining God's kingdom would be to describe it as God's reign here on earth. Since God created the earth in love, God has a right to be the reigning presence here, which simply means that God is loving and faithful to everything God created, and it is God's desire that all of creation be loving and faithful to God as well. This particular parable has been interpreted down through the ages by many different theologians. After reading four different perspectives in my commentary, and after some reflection, I've discerned an interpretation that makes sense to me. As I learned in theological school, Jesus' parables were spoken to make his disciples think, reflect, and learn, perhaps getting them to look at something from a different point of view. Normally, after hearing this story, It's common for people to make assumptions. For instance, if you take it at face value, this story does not seem just or fair, and it's hard for us to comprehend, as we've always been taught, that God is just and fair. So on the surface, one might assume that the parable is trying to teach us about justice and fairness, but to me, it really doesn't point in that direction. However, this parable is an analogy. Jesus always used analogies to help his listeners understand the way of the kingdom. He set his stories in familiar settings and used words they could relate to. And they often began with the same phrase, "The kingdom of heaven is like," or "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to." In this parable, I see God as the landowner. God is seeking people to work for his kingdom, or, in other words, to come to the realization that they are part of his glorious creation, and that means working together for the good of all. Whether they come to that realization early on in life and work for the kingdom of God all the way through, or whether they come to the realization later in life and only work for the kingdom a short while, God is astoundingly generous in offering the exact wage or reward to one and all. No one is better than another because they've worked longer for the kingdom or harder or with more zeal than another. No one is more or less deserving than anyone else. If the denarius represents life with God after physical death, or salvation, as some would call it, then all are worthy of it, no matter when they began to work for the kingdom. This parable shows that God is not idle when it comes to looking for us and calling us to come and work for the kingdom. It shows that God is constantly with us, calling us at every stage of our lives and extending a hand of welcome. God is faithful in loving each of us unconditionally and extending that welcoming hand of grace through Jesus Christ. God is and always will be forgiving when we turn to God and accept the invitation. That's when we'll begin to work for God's kingdom in whatever way God leads us. Every single person was created with unique talents that could be used to enhance God's kingdom here on earth. Whether we're artists, artisans, musicians, singers, gardeners, cooks, nurses, doctors, teachers, lawyers, you name it, we've been given gifts that can be used to show love for God, love for others, and love for creation. And it's when we acknowledge our relationship with God and go about using our gifts here and now that we begin to understand our gifts are not about us. Our gifts are not about us and the glory we could receive by using them. Our gifts that we use to enhance this world are God-given gifts, and the glory should go to God. In this way, we learn humility. Whether you're the world's greatest gifted surgeon, or whether you're a person who just walked down the street and shared your sandwich with a homeless person, you are all equals, all three of you, and equally loved by God. Whatever loving act you're doing to enhance God's kingdom is welcomed by God, as are you. For without God, there would be no creation, no earth, no people. Life on this planet is a great gift, and anything we do to show love and appreciation will make God smile. We are all children of God, and we are loved beyond imagination. But the things we do to enhance the kingdom are not counted as merit points. The works we do and the amount or depth of faith that we have is irrelevant to God. God's Holy Spirit welcomes all and works in and through all for the benefit of the kingdom. This is the way that God reigns. It's the way that brings justice, peace, love, and healing to the earth and to its peoples. It's by God's grace that Jesus, God's Son, was sent to earth to teach us about the faithfulness of God. Whether or not we feel worthy or deserving of God's love, it doesn't matter. In God's eyes, we are loved. Period. If you think God has never done anything to help you, so why should you pay attention to God? Then I'd say, think again. Take a look at your past. Really look deep and see if you can find God's loving intervention in your life, even if you weren't paying attention to God. Sometimes when we look back at our lives, we begin to see a pattern where things just came together for seemingly no reason. You may have thought it was a coincidence. I've started to call them God-cidents. I'm truly amazed when I look back at my own life and I see that certain people came into my life just when I needed them most. People with wisdom and grace. People that were loving, supportive, and nurturing. People that accepted me for who I was at the time and helped me grow into who I am today. My husband, for one. And also some wonderful spiritual mentors as well that I met through attending worship at church. A great place to meet people, especially spiritual mentors. From them, I learned to listen for God's voice, especially when things are busy or hectic, or when one feels lost or alone. I learned it's more important to spend time with Jesus by reading the gospel stories because Jesus is the light of the world and can guide us throughout our faith journey. Jesus' wise words and ways always point to God's steadfast love and faithfulness. And I found that once comfortable reading scripture, it's easier to talk to God as well as sense God's loving presence through the Holy Spirit that lives in our hearts. This then makes it easier to be comforted by God and to know that I have the strength to persevere through difficult times. With the Holy Spirit reminding us of Jesus, one begins to understand that the way forward is to live in a loving relationship with God and be an active participant in God's kingdom here on earth. That's how faith begins to grow and blossom, making God's kingdom even more beautiful. Being faithful to God and others isn't always easy, so it's helpful to spend time with other people who are like-minded when it comes to living our faith. Christians spend time with other Christians and are therefore a support system for each other. It's always easier to worship God and work for God's kingdom alongside other people who do the same. As I said before, we'll not earn merit points, but we'll gradually transform into the loving and faithful people God created us to be. The earliest workers in the parable were concerned that the later workers got the same reward as them, even though the earliest workers had worked longer hours in the heat of the day. They even complained that the landowner gave everyone the same reward, making them all equal, even though the earliest workers felt they were better because they had worked longer. But this just shows God's great generosity towards all people. God does not make comparisons. No one is better or stronger or smarter. Everyone is loved equally and totally by God and deserves the same reward. For each person's relationship with God is unique, one of a kind. And you can't compare something that is unique to something else that is unique. But if we use our uniqueness to promote God's loving ways in the world, it will show our love for God. It will show we care about God and God's loving ways, and that we'll want to work in God's kingdom simply because we love God. Not because we think we'll get a greater reward than anyone else in the end. That is being faithful to God. God didn't create us to walk in this life alone. God created us to walk with God. And because of that, we have God's faithfulness to us, and in return, God has ours. Faithfulness says it all. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let's continue to praise God with our next hymn from Voices United, number 288, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thank you.
Just love that hymn. As a loving response to God's word, God's Son, Jesus Christ, and to God's love and faithfulness down through the ages, we bring before God our heartfelt gratitude by offering our time, talent, and financial contributions to the work of God's kingdom. Although we can't bring forward our offering plates to place on the communion table as we did prior to COVID-19, the offering that you placed in the offering containers as you came in, or will place as you go out, or that you gave during the week, or you gave through PAR, will be blessed to do God's work in the world. We thank you for supporting the mission and ministry Jesus gave us to do through Woodlawn United Church, for this church family is dedicated to serving others in this community and beyond in the name of our friend and Savior, Jesus Christ. So let's listen to verse 1 of our musical response for the fruit of all creation before we give thanks in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we are thankful for the beauty of creation and the gifts we receive through creation, such as our faithful farmers, a plentiful harvest, and the dedicated people in our food industry that provide for our needs. We thank you for your love and faithfulness that have continued throughout history into our present day, and trust they will continue into the future. Guide us, Holy One, to be aware of the needs of others, and show us ways to fulfill those needs as we serve them in love. May we always be faithful in responding to your call and blessing others through the work of our hands as your Holy Spirit leads. As a loving and faithful response to you, O God, we offer our gifts and ask for your blessing upon them, so they may be used to fulfill mission and ministry in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Following a new creed, I'll say the prayers of the people, ending in a recording of the Lord's Prayer. I'll offer a blessing. Then we'll hear verse 1 of We Shall Go Out with Hope of Resurrection. And finally, Gus will play a postlude to conclude our worship. After the postlude, the ushers will lead each person out of the sanctuary. It is time for a new creed. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating.
Who has come, Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the Church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our Judge and our Lord. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Gracious God, awesome creator and sustainer of life. Thank you for the wonders of the earth, the richness of its beauty and astounding life all around us. May we always be grateful for this planet that is our home, even when times are difficult, such as the seasons we endure that bring hurricanes, forest fires, and floods. For the Earth has its struggles these days with global warming and climate change. We know these things are the results of human neglect and errors down through the ages, and now our Earth must suffer the consequences. Help us, O God, as we face these natural disasters, but even more, help us to fix the problems of global warming and climate change before it's too late. Help our governments to plant the trees that need to be planted, even if COVID-19 is interrupting this important task. For the earth needs many trees in order to flourish again. Compassionate God, the world continues to work against the clock, searching for a vaccine that will gradually ease the horror of this global pandemic. We know you are loving and faithful to your creation, so we pray for your gracious Holy Spirit to work in ways that will guide scientists, medical communities, and those in manufacturing to find a cure and distribute it faithfully to every corner of the earth. May all people understand the seriousness of this virus and work to obey the COVID-19 rules and regulations that are in place to keep everyone safe. Help us not to be lax in keeping alert, for that is when we will lose the battle. We pray for your love and comfort to surround people around the world who are suffering and grieving. In our daily interactions, may we always show love and compassion to every person. We lift up our hearts in gratitude. O Holy One, you love us unconditionally by your grace offered through Jesus Christ, who died on a cross and rose 3 days later, having conquered death. This is the greatest gift of all. Your faithfulness has given us new life in Christ forever. Thank you for this amazing gift. Loving God, we know we are never alone, for your Holy Spirit is constantly with us. But in our times of anxiety, sickness, loss, and grief, we need assurance. So we ask for your comforting presence to fill us. Help us feel the arms of Jesus hugging us close. We trust you, O God. So we hand these matters over to you, knowing you are faithful. We give you our thanks. Now in silence, we name our concerns and the people on our hearts. Gracious God, we lift up these concerns and the dear ones we've named into your loving care. As we pray in our hearts, the comforting words of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As we leave our worship today, may God bless and keep us, reminding us of God's great love and faithfulness to us and all of creation. May we, in turn, show our great love and faithfulness to God as we work together for the benefit of all in God's great kingdom, serving others in love. And may the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and always. Amen.